edition of the annual Institute Lecture Series of IIEST Shippur being organized in collaboration with British Council. This prestigious lecture series was initiated by the director of IIEST Shippur, Professor Ajoy Kumar Ray, in 2014 in memory of some of the greatest minds of India. There are six orations in a cycle, namely the Swami Vivekananda, Acharya Jagdish Chandra Bose, Acharya Prafulla Chandra Roy, Rabindranath Tagore, M. Vishveshwaraya, and the Ramanujan Memorial Orations. The first cycle has been successfully completed last year, and today we launch the second cycle with the Swami Vivekananda Memorial Oration to be delivered by an eminent personality in the area of science and technology studies, Professor John Agar from the University College of London. Before we proceed, may I request Professor John Agar, Ms. Shujata Sen, Director, British Council, East India, and Professor Vichitra Kumar Guho, Dean, Faculty Affairs, IIEST, to be kindly seated at the dais. Students of the Institute will now offer flower tributes to the dignitaries, to Professor John Agar. To Ms. Shujata Sen. To Professor Vichitra Kumar Guho, Dean, Faculty Affairs, IIEST Shippur. Students. The Dean Faculty Affairs, Professor Vichitra Kumar Guho, is now requested to present the welcome address.
Thank you, Professor Ghosh. It's really a great pleasure for me to welcome Professor John Agar, Professor of the University College of London, and the delegates from British Council, headed by Ms. Sujata Sen, to our institute, the Indian Institute of Engineering, Science and Technology. As already elaborated by Professor Aparna Ghosh, this series of institute lectures was planned by our beloved director, Professor A.K. Ray, and it started last year, completing the first cycle. It's really good to see that the second cycle is launched, and today we are assembled here to listen to Professor Agar about the big themes of science in the 20th century. And this lecture on the themes of science is organized in the memory of Swami Vivekananda, an immortal soul of the Indian soil. Swami Vivekananda, as the name itself indicates, he was a monk. He founded the Ramakrishna Mission and all that. But Swami Vivekananda was a monk with a difference. He did not escape from the society, did not take recluse in the hills and mountains and went on meditating on God. No, he was not a monk like that. He very much appreciated the hardships of the common people of India. He very much was concerned about the education of the general people of India. He was concerned about the needs of the Indian people in general. And he always used to say that you cannot practice religion unless you are well fed, unless you satisfy your spirit, unless you satisfy your body and mind fully. He also said that the education is no education that does not give you bread. He was such a monk with a distinction. And yes, it's a very, I think it's quite appropriate that we are arranging a lecture on science in memory of Swami Vivekananda. Vivekananda toured extensively in USA and England. He saw the state of industrial revolution in those countries. He compared the state of the people in the States and UK and also in India. And he understood the state in which our people are compared to the people in the developed countries. So he wanted that our people should also develop themselves so that they can be equal or maybe even greater than the people of the Western countries. So okay, we are eager to hear to Professor Agar about the big themes of 20th century science. It is really looking back towards the last century. In fact, the story of science, the history of science, in fact, it started in the world long back, not less than 4,000 years back, I think, starting from the priests of Babylon, followed by the Greek civilization, followed by that in Alexandria, and then after a long dark period in Europe in the Middle Ages, from the time of Renaissance, the science started in full-fledged in its modern form. In fact, I can quote a very interesting poem. It was written by Alexander Pope, the poet laureate of England, who was also a friend of Sir Isaac Newton. It goes like this: "Nature and nature's laws lay hid in the dark of night. God said, let there be Newton, and there was light." So that way Newton actually ushered in the light. He produced the light of science based on which the modern civilization started growing. The 20th century, we always think that the 20th century saw a revolution in science and technology. But perhaps this revolution, it looked like a revolution because the pace of progress of science and technology was tremendous in that century compared to the centuries earlier to it. In fact, I can also quote Lord Kelvin, a very great scientist of England. By the end of the 19th century, in the 1890s, he said that, well, we have already known whatever there is to know about nature. There is no more new findings to come. The research from now on will be aimed only to increase the accuracy and precision of measurements. So, for example, you can find out the gravitational constant to more and more decimal places. That way you increase your accuracy, that will be your only objective in research from now on. Little did he know that within a few years, the world will be shaken by five papers, immortal papers written by Albert Einstein in 1905, that shook the foundation of the classical physics. As a matter of fact, during Kelvin's days, people knew only about two types of forces, only the gravitational forces and the electromagnetic forces. But the 20th century, the quantum mechanics came, and with it came the nuclear physics. We started knowing about the strong forces, the weak forces. Then the gravitational theory of Newton was put into question, and Einstein developed the general theory of relativity based on which the modern cosmology was created, and the theory of Big Bang and so on and so on. And what about this technological revolution? When semiconductors were discovered, and then point contact transistors were discovered by Bardeen, Breton and Shotley, who were in 1947, I think, something like that. Then the real revolution in the technology began. Even in the 1980s, by the term telephone, we used to mean only landline. And it was quite a luxurious item, in fact, in the houses of the common people to get a telephone. Within 10 years, we are always using this mobile phone and roaming, and generation after generation, newer and newer mobile phones are being invented. communication technology has seen a great revolution. Medical science is seeing a revolution, and I don't know where we are progressing. But the progress is rapid. The progress is very, very fast. Do we ever hope to reach the end? No. As Lord Kelvin's statements proved, science or its development will never end. We will go on unveiling the mysteries of nature slowly but progressively, and we will approach the truth asymptotically, never quite reaching it. Let science grow, let technology grow, let our students take part in this great revolutionary progress of science and technology in the world over. And now, I would request Ms. Shriyata, well, I would hand over the microphone to Professor Ghosh to formally start the lecture by Professor Agar. Thank you, Professor Agar.
Thank you, Professor Guha. I must mention that Professor Guha is Professor of Physics here. Now, I invite Ms. Sujata Sen, Director of British Council Eastern India, to formally introduce Professor John Agar.
Thank you, Professor Ghosh and Professor Guha. And while listening to you, Professor Guha, I was wishing that I was a student of yours and I could listen more lectures by you. My warm welcome to everyone who's present here, all the students and all those who've also come from outside. And thank you for giving us the honor of partnering you for the Swami Vivekananda Memorial Oration. And we're so delighted to have John here to deliver that lecture. Formal introduction to John is due. He's Professor of Science and Technology Studies and writes on contemporary technologies, including about mobile phones and ID cards, and the history of modern science and technology. He has authored several books by Quality Press in 2012. He's also the editor of the British Journal for the History of Science. He talks on several radio programs discussing history of science and technology. His latest podcast called Science in the 20th Century and Beyond covers topics such as the challenges of writing about both the history of life and physical sciences, cross-disciplinary and global histories, accounting for the rise of American science, why 1900 is not a bad time to start a history of science, science and warfare, and the working world's argument. He won the Dean's Award for teaching at Harvard University in 2007, and his thesis was awarded the UKC Development Trust Prize for the best thesis in the Faculty of Humanities in 1997. We're proud to have John here to talk to us about the big themes of science in the last 100 years. Thank you, John.
Thank you very much. I do feel very strange next to this picture back when I had hair, not that long ago.
Show me.
Lights. Okay. So I think, can you hear me at the back? Well, first of all, I would like to say thank you very much. Thank you very much to the British Council for bringing me here. Thank you very much for professors and all the other faculty that I've met. Particularly thank you to the students who did some wonderful presentations and a discussion about their work to do with the interrelation of science, society and humanities that I had the privilege and the pleasure to hear just before this talk. And thank you everyone else for being here. I did want to start because this is the Swami Vivekananda memorial lecture, and I understand it's also part of a cycle that also includes Jagadish Chandra Bose. So I thought a rather good way of introducing some of the things that I'll be talking about would be to remind you of an encounter between those two in 1900, in the very first year of the 20th century. Because often Swami Vivekananda is extremely known for the depth and wisdom of his religious thought, but as we heard, he wasn't a monk, he lived on the mountainside. He was one who's concerned with broader social problems, but also had all kinds of intellectual connections and all kinds of interesting influences elsewhere. And as you know, Bose conducted an extremely famous demonstration of the newly discovered Hertzian waves, what we'd call radio waves, but of course what Bose was using was microwave, something that actually really no one else in the world had had demonstrated at that point. And he used that in a very famous demonstration here in Kolkata. And it's a demonstration not only of a new physical phenomena of these Hertzian waves, but actually it's also a demonstration of the internationalism of science at that stage. If you think that Heinrich Hertz was a German, he found a phenomenon that had been comes out of the theoretical ideas of a Scot, James Clerk Maxwell, and Bose had taken that discovery and developed it even further, and was the start of very important work in India. Now, in 1900, Bose was at the International Congress for Science in Paris. Again, this is part of the sort of international character of science, that it was gatherings of people from all over the world to hear about, in this case, physics. And Swami Vivekananda was in the audience when Bose gave a talk. And he later recalled in writing his thoughts, his feelings about hearing Bose. So hearing physics by this Indian physicist on a world stage in Paris. And this is the words of Swami Vivekananda. He said that here in Paris have assembled the great of every land, each to proclaim the glory of his country. Savants, the knowledgeable, will be acclaimed here, and its reverberations will glorify their countries. Among these peerless men gathered from all parts of the world, where is thy representative, O thou country of thy birth? Out of the vast assembly, say India, a young man stood for thee, one of thy heroic sons, whose words here electrified the audience and will thrill his countrymen. Now, I find that quotation fascinating because that, for several reasons, and many of those actually illustrate some of the themes that I want to pick up in my talk. First of all, you've got this sense of science being, or certainly by the end of the 19th century, this organised international activity, that it has its international congresses, for example. It's the peerless men who gather from all parts of the world. But the second thing is an intense connection still with nations, right? That Swami Vivekananda's prior in Bose was that as a representative of a nation. So there's also something very interesting there about nations and incipient nationhood that Bose, for Swami Vivekananda, stood for. And certainly that theme of what do you do, how do you account for the history of science in terms of nation and nationhood is a key theme that I want to address, because it's actually quite both interesting, important, but also difficult for science in the 20th century. And the second thing that comes out of that is about the word that Vivekananda there used, about representatives, which I use in a slightly different way, but it also made me think about some of the themes in this talk. So, if I move away from the microphone, I hope you can still hear me. I do like to sort of wander around.
It's audible.
You've got
it's audible.
Yeah, the column.
It's okay. Good. That's fine. So I thought what I'd do is just introduce a little bit about myself, because I come from a Department of Science and Technology Studies, which is it doesn't do all science and technology, because that would be crazy. What it is a study of science and technology from different perspectives, and those are mostly humanities and social science perspective. So we have historical ways of looking at science and technology, philosophical ways, sociological or policy-oriented ways. Now I'm a historian, so the way I think about science and technology is in terms of its development over time. But I wanted to give you some sense of why it might be worth doing history of science at all. Now I'm assuming that there's not many card-carrying historians of science in the audience, and that's absolutely fine. But you may therefore be wondering, what's it about? You know, why would you want to do this sort of subject? And this is a real question, and it's probably a question that perhaps you've encountered yourselves, so that you know, when you go home and you meet your relatives back at home and you tell them about the research that you're doing, sometimes you get this question, and that is, why? Why are you doing that, right? For me, it's a tricky question. Why do history of science? I think if you're doing engineering, IT, or you're doing medical science, it's a little bit easier as a question to answer. But for history of science, what's the point of doing history of science? Now, part of the answer is to do with what your image of science is. So if your image of science is that it's a progressive discovery of ever closer truths about the world, then perhaps looking at the past of science is not quite so useful, right? Because you know your past science is less accurate science. What's the point of reconstructing that? Why not go and do the more important, interesting, better work at the frontiers of knowledge? Right. Another way of thinking of science is maybe it's quite an insulated affair. So it's responding to ideas and arguments that mostly come from other scientists. In which case, the history of it would also be rather insulated and self-contained. Why? You could write the history, certainly, but it wouldn't be of great interest to those people outside. Now, I think both those pictures of science are actually seriously misleading. I think science has changed radically over the centuries. So what counts as knowledge, as reliable knowledge of the natural world, let us say, has changed. I also think that it's not an insulated kind of activity, and in very important ways it responds to and gets pushed and pulled by all kinds of interesting forces. So that when you're talking about how it is and your ideas, it's also about a wider world. But the other third, I think, really important reason why the history of science is important is best introduced by showing you a picture. It's a photograph, and I think it's one of the most extraordinary photographs ever made in the 20th century. this is. I don't know whether anyone's seen it before, or if anyone can tell me what it is, what it shows. Any suggestions?
It's showing a dead cell through microscope by
a Lewin hook. It looks like something through a microscope. Ah, the Lewin hook, yes. Very early microscopic picture. Yeah. Because it does look organic. Like it looks like a sort of tiny microorganism or something you might see under a microscope. It's not organic, that's a clinic. What did you say?
Looking more or less like a plant cell with its
or
cell
wall. Plant cell. Yeah, again, it looks like a... I mean, to me, it reminds me of a sprouting chickpea or something, doesn't it? Right? That's what I look at. But it's not organic. It's nothing organic. In fact, it's about as far as organic as you can get. You can just see here a gantry, a metal structure that's holding up something. This is a photograph of the detonation of the first atomic bomb, not atomic device, in 1945, the Trinity test. And it's taken microseconds after the detonation. So that is a nuclear fireball, but it's only a few tens of meters across. And in some ways, that is an extraordinary achievement, a technical achievement, to take that photograph. Because it had such a short period of time to capture that picture. But for me, it's also, I think, an illustration of something very important that happened in the 20th century, which is the start of the nuclear age. And this is the first image from the very start of the nuclear age. And in that kind, when you think about that kind of moment, and you think that what led up to this moment? Well, it was discoveries, as we heard in the introduction, in the very first few years of the 20th century, the new physics that was developed there. And within a few decades, it has these kinds of applications and consequences. So one very important reason for studying the history of science is that important parts of the history of the world can be affected consequently. So it's not an insulated thing, it does have effects. It's very important to have a look at. So what I want to do is give you some sense of what you see if you try and get a stand back and get a picture of science in the 20th century in general. But before I do that, it's quite important to see where history of science has got to. A couple of years ago this picture was taken. It's of the International Congress for the History of Science, Technology and Medicine. And 1,800 historians of science gathered, some of them from I think 58 different countries, including India. And I was amazed. It's just like, I couldn't believe there's quite so many historians of science in the world. It is a thriving discipline. And I suppose, going back to the question of what do you tell your relative, who said, wonders why you're doing that subject, well, you can say, well, I'm not going to be lonely, at least. That's quite good. But because there's so many, I think, historians of science, that a tendency has occurred that we tend to look at things in a quite a narrow way, that we often do case study histories, which are studies of a particular time or a particular place or a particular scientific development, right? And that's great. You get a nice detailed picture of quite a focused moment. And we sometimes collect these into edited collections with certain sort of themes. And that's a way of pulling things together, seeing a broader picture. But in general, partly because there's a sort of fine division of labour that's developed, lots of people working in this area, we don't often try and do something synthetic, something that tries to step back and see what the broader picture is. There's possible problems with that. So what? One of the thoughts I had was, well, if I do try and take all the wealth of good history of science that's been done about science in the 20th century and reassemble it, take all those parts, reanimate it, is the result going to be dangerous? Or is the result going to be something more harmonious that we can see interesting, useful patterns? But that's the task I set myself. So the book that was mentioned in the introduction, Science in the 20th Century Beyond, was an attempt to be synthetic, to try and explore what the sort of more general themes would be. What stands out, what looks important, what questions can you ask that perhaps you couldn't necessarily ask very easily with a more focused view. And that's why I want to give you some sense of what the conclusions of that were. Now, the first conclusion is to do with what do you do with the history of science in different nations. Now, one of the features of science in the 20th century is that it got more expensive for reasons that I will talk about in a minute. And because it got more expensive, who was going to pay for it? Now, in the time of Newton, for example, who's mentioned earlier, or even the time of Darwin, then typically it would be supported by a private income, less likely to have sort of state-funded science. So one of the key developments in the 20th century is the growing importance of the state as an important funder of the sciences.
State?
The state. So the nation. Yeah. Now that means that that national contexts shape the sciences in quite important ways in the 20th century. Which means that it does make sense to look sometimes at science in the 20th century in terms of how it develops differently in different countries. But one thing is that I noticed is that actually sometimes we don't have very good ways of exploring or analysing that topic. So, for example, if you look at the United States, at the beginning of the 20th century, the United States was very much a second rank power in the sciences. You would say, where was the exciting science going on? It would be in countries such as Germany. But by the mid-20th century, that picture has changed. And if you take almost any measure in the 20th century, whether it's amount of funds or winning of Nobel Prizes, then there's no doubt that the United States is one of those countries that you need to pay attention to. There's something interesting going on there. And historians, when they've looked at that, have so far not given a very good explanation, I think. Partly because it's very fraught. There's a certain sort of nationalism when it comes to the way people think about science in countries. Right? And that makes historians nervous. Especially bearing in mind that most science, most knowledge comes from abroad for all countries. Likewise, most technology comes from abroad for all countries. And so when it comes to the United States, there's lots of different kinds of explanations which are actually inconsistent, incoherent. Some of these, for example, involve state in an important way, and some of them don't. Nevertheless, it is, I think, a first observation is that science in the 20th century does mean different things in different national contexts. This is an illustration of another key moment in 20th century science. We already had the detonation of the atomic bomb. The figures here I'm sure, recognise. On the right is Joseph Stalin. And on the left, does anyone recognise or know who that figure is? That is Trofim Lysenko, of Lysenkoism. And Lysenko is denouncing geneticists. and Joseph Stalin is a bravo comrade. It's quite an important moment in the sciences, and it also reminds us when historians have examined those very good histories of science in Russia, that actually the relations between science and government have always there been very front of mind. So even types of explanation vary from country to country. So that's my first point. My first point is simply a rather sort of, is a point about nationhood and science. My second point is much more, is much simpler, I think. Now, it could be easily stated. It's to do with the unmissable increase in scale in science in the 20th century. It gets larger in very important ways in different dimensions. It employs more people, it costs more money, it involves bigger machines and instruments. There's often a military dimension to it. Now, what's notice about this is that it was recognised at the time as one of the great transformations that was going on in the sciences and the organisation of the sciences in the 20th century. So it's a bit of a dense quotation, I apologise for that. But let me explain where it comes from. I've picked this quotation, it comes from a book by Janivi Falky, who's a very good Indian historian of Indian science. It's from her book, Atomic State, Big Science in 20th Century India. And even though it's got the name, the relations of physics to with often politicians and political leaders in the 1930s and 1940s, really before any atomic project was developed. Now, this quotation is by the New Zealand, comes from the New Zealander Ernest Rutherford. It's a written speech. It's written because he died actually before he could deliver it. And it was a speech to the Indian Science Congress, which is now over 100 years. I believe it's just finished, or is it still going on? I'm not sure. It's just finished, yeah. Somewhat controversially, possibly. I've been following it, there's been some interesting discussion. But this is from 1938, and Rutherford wants to draw everyone's attention to a particular development, and he sees it as being very important. And he says, "I cannot but reflect on the amazing contrast between my first experiment on the transmutation of nitrogen in 1919. and the large-scale experiments on transmutation that are now in progress in many parts of the world." And then he goes on, he compares the old picture, which was of an observer, an individual, in a dark room with very simple apparatus, painfully counting with a microscope the few scintillations originating from the bombardment of nitrogen by a source of particles. And he contrasts that with what he could see then, which was a large-scale apparatus that was available to him. A great hall containing massive and elaborate machinery. And of course, that was the 1930s. Within a decade or more, it would be even more extraordinary in terms of the scale. But that remarkable change in the scale of research was evident to contemporaries, and it's undoubtedly one of the most important features of 20th century science. And it's worth just reminding us a little, I'll just show you some photographs just to make that point even clearer. We saw the atomic detonation. Of course, it's a project, the Manhattan Project, which wasn't just at Los Alamos, but was also at several other sites, Oak Ridge and Hanford, where the separation of nuclear material took place. And the pictures of those sites, it is Oak Ridge. These are cities for science that have been built in a matter of only a handful of years, an idea that would have been incomprehensible at the turn of the century to scientists and engineers. There's Hanford. And these are places that were so large, they needed schools, they needed hospitals, they needed places to live. They even needed cinemas. The idea that you might need to have good cinemas to support the scientific engineering project would have been extraordinary. Now that increased scale in science is also something that we find not only in the physical sciences in the 20th century, but also in the life sciences. This is an image which shows the front covers of Science and Nature magazine when the announcement of the completion of the Human Genome Project, or at least a partial, a milestone in that process. Now, you'll notice that one was physical sciences, one was life sciences, and actually a sort of third theme or trend in the 20th century was a swing of emphasis from the physical to the life sciences in quite an interesting way, where life sciences also sometimes quite explicitly adopted that model of mission-oriented science. Now for my fourth theme, I just want to approach it in a slightly roundabout way. Now imagine that you are on an airliner, it's at night, and you're over a city, and what you see is a collection of very bright points of light. It's a sublime sight, it's one of the most beautiful things you can see, but what you don't really see is a sort of purpose behind it. Now if you're on that flight, and you, at the end of the flight, you come into another city, and it's dawn, you begin to see not only the points of light, but also the movement of the city, the movement of the cars, people, the world, the city going to work. And actually, all those points of light begin to make a certain kind of sense that they didn't earlier on. Now, that is a rather crude metaphor for something that I think does help us think about the place of science in the 20th century. So if we took just the very bright points, the bright stars of science, so individual moments like the discovery of quantum mechanics or the detonation of atomic weapons or the completion of the Human Genome Project, what we end up with is a rather impoverished kind of history and not one that does much explanation. But if we try and set those lights in terms of a wider world of work, then actually we begin to make sense of that pattern of light. So that's what I call working worlds. Working worlds are arenas of human activity that generate problems. And they're ones which provide a context for an awful lot of science in the 20th century. And they include things like building technological systems, building mobilising defence systems, military systems, the maintenance of human health, both other organisms, civil administration, and aspects of global order, particularly environmental, global stability. And what they do is something also, I was quite surprised how often a certain pattern arose, that there might be an articulation of a problem. But where science gets involved, it's not where the problems can be solved in any way directly. What happens is a more abstract representative of that problem is generated, one on which the techniques of science can be applied, and through application in that way, solutions, or at least solutions can be offered back to where problems are felt. So you can put that sort of picture quite odd in this form, whereas working worlds, there are problems, there are simplified representatives, and there's scientific activity.
And just give you one very quick example of how, what that, give you an example. So, in the world of government, understanding population, populations are people. People are incredibly complicated. So, have all kinds of problems, right? All kinds of issues from the government's point of view. How does the government respond? Well, one way it responds is by taking a census. And what is a census if it's not a representative, a simplified representative, sure, of the population more broadly, but one which is amenable to statistical techniques of various kinds. So that's a very simple case. What I'm surprised by, and this is, I think, one of the points I really want to share with you, is actually sometimes that kind of contextual story, historical account, actually tells us something about kinds of science that you might expect to be very theoretical and not really connected to a wider world. There's a very good book about the German Meteorological Laboratory by David Cahan called An Institute for Empire. And in that we find an account of how Max Planck, what sort of data was Max Planck working with when he first wrote down equations which Einstein interprets in a quantum fashion. It's a very important moment right at the beginning of the century that basically launches this new non-classical physics. And it's very important for, I mean, Max Planck was one of the very first theoretical physicists who thought of himself as working on theory. That was actually quite a new style of working or specialty. Yet what he was working with was the very fine data that was being generated by the Meteorological Laboratory. Why was the Meteorological Laboratory generating that data at all? It's because the electrical lighting industry had said there's a specific problem, right, with understanding luminosity of black body radiation. So what was going on there was that there was problems being encountered by industry, being articulated, particular data sets being generated to model that. And Max Planck being drawn in to make sense and understand those. So it's no surprise that working is kind of how some of applied science works. But my surprise was actually some of the theoretical moments in science also falls onto that pattern. But I want to give you one more worked example, then I'll start wrapping up. It's an example that comes from one of the greatest problems of the 20th century, and that is global conflict and new technologies of warfare. The aircraft, which really came into being at the very start of the century, by the First World War was being used for military purposes, by the 1920s and 30s was being regarded as a existential threat, because the bomber, it was thought, would always get through. So the next wars would be wars in which cities, civilian populations, might be destroyed. And that's to do with the speed of the aircraft. It comes too quickly, it can't be detected, there's no early warning. So that's a very good example of a problem that is seen as a question of information. If you look down here, it's what this diagram of a defence system is organised by incoming and outgoing information. These radar systems are one of the sources of information as we now see it. Information not just as communication, but as something which has an ontology. We now think of the information age or information technologies.
these ones, one of the very first things described as information systems. That sort of sense of our world as being something shaped by information comes from these kinds of moments. It also comes from a way this information is dealt with. It's reduced, it's filtered, so that eventually the incredibly complex world of warfare, about as messy a world as it could be, is reduced down to information that you could put on a chart like this. And on top, and with this, a new science is generated. Those are operational rooms, and this is operational research that is, becomes a science of that kind of representation, representative data. So new scientists get generated. Figure that you may know Patrick Blackett. He was an advisor to Nehru in the 1950s. He was one of the key people in developing this science. Describes operational research as the analysis of actual operations, using as data the material to be found in operations rooms. So new kind of science that is springs directly from that act of production. One more example of a new science that comes out of this, there are spin-off sciences. Radio astronomy, of which there's very interesting Indian developments and international collaborations involving work going on in this country, is an outcome of taking up radar equipment and turning it not to aircraft but to the stars. One of the people here who was involved with this was this character here, Bernard Lovell, a physicist who went into devising radar ways of producing information and representing it. One of the key figures for promoting larger designs of radio telescope. And radio astronomy itself is a spin-off new science of all this work. I did want to tell you about him, though, for another reason. And that is, he is also the inventor, if you're interested in cricket, which I imagine some of you are, he's the inventor of the devices, the very first devices for picking up whether a ball has touched the bat or not. It's history that starts as tragedy and repeats as farce. But it's also, if you think about it, precisely the same problem as the aircraft. It's a fast-moving object of which human observers are incapable of making sound judgments. Right. That gives you some sense of working worlds. There's also some policy thoughts you could think, rather than thinking backwards about the past, thinking forwards about the future. If that is a typical pattern of relation of science to a wider world, you could think about it in terms of going forward. Who gets to articulate problems? Is it politicians? Is it scientists? What role should the public have? Can the process of articulation be improved? Do working worlds with different national contexts? I'd be very interested to hear your thoughts about that. Are artificial challenges useful? So setting prizes, for example, we live in a world of prizes. There are new prizes for sequencing genomes, for private companies to get spaceships into space and back. It's actually a return to an 18th, 19th century way of encouraging innovation. It's very strange. But we might wonder whether it's as effective as other ways of encouraging innovation. And finally, there's plenty missing. There's plenty of histories of institutions, of key people, of key countries, which are missing at the moment. And it's very difficult then to get an accurate view of what the key themes, key developments of science in the 20th century are. There's plenty more that needs to be read, thought about, argued about for this subject. So I'll just conclude really. I've tried to give some sense of not just the sort of key discoveries or theories, because I think those are the sort of points of light that you will be familiar with, I think, but you don't necessarily, I think if you just see the points of light, see what generates them, what sustains them, how do they make sense of a broader story of influences and forces that shape our world. So what I've tried to give you a sense is some of that broader picture, that there is a question about nations and histories and ideologies. There's an unmissable feature of 20th century science, which is the increase of scale of science. There is plausibly a swing of emphasis, or certainly a learning of interconnection between physical science and life sciences. There's a common pattern. Not doesn't apply to all cases, but it does apply to some surprising cases about working worlds. And there's still plenty of gaps. There's still plenty of things that we don't know very well. We need further research. So I hope you thought that was stimulating. Thank you very much. If you would like to contact me, that's my email address, my Twitter handle, and I'm very happy to be in conversation. But I think there's also going to be some questions now as well.
Yeah, some lights.
Thank you very much, Professor Agar. That was indeed a very stimulating lecture. And I would now invite questions from the audience. I think Ms. Sen would like to moderate that.
Yes. Any questions? Can I see the first few hands going up? Hi. My question is about the history of science as a subject. How early do you think it is in the history of science?
Light here, the regular light is.
In terms of studies, what are you talking about?
So what level of education would that be like? Oh, that's a very good question, because usually people come across it very late. So I don't think it's a school subject at all, and that's a shame, because I think science and technology are such important parts of our world, and to understand where we are now, I do think it's essential to understand the path to where we get now. And I think that is as true for the understanding you get from at school level as it is at university level. It's you're very unlikely to do much at school, at least in my experience. In Britain, I don't know whether it's true, for example, of India. Even at university, not many students come across it. Sometimes it's part of, as an option in science-based degrees. Sometimes it's joined with philosophy, because sort of history and philosophy of science go together very nicely. Sometimes you find it in other areas as well. I would love to see it being taught much earlier, so if it could be part of a school curriculum, and I would love to see it being a more general part of education, even at higher education levels, because I think it does allow you to step back and think about not only the really important technical side, but also to think about how that fits into a broader picture. So, I mean, as early as possible is my answer, but that's rather self-contained.
আপনি বলবেন তো এইটা কিন্তু উপর দিকে তুলে দেবে লাস্ট
ইন্ট্রোডাকশন মেনশন ইউজড আ লট অফ সেকেন্ডারি সোর্সেস
So as historians, we talk to use more of primary.
Yes.
So is it something that you would encourage historians of science to do instead of...
Thank you. Thank you for reading my book. That's well done. It's quite long. So, but it's too long. But first of all, you're using the word external in quite rightly in a specific sense. It's a style of doing history science that says that what's important is not just what contrasted to is internalist history of science, which is really only paying attention to the cognitive, intellectual elements it's a history of ideas, essentially. And external history of science was, I suppose, the opposite. It's for some, it was not paying attention to the ideas, but saying it's a social and political structure through and through. Right? Now, I think you need both. You absolutely need both. And I think the examples I gave of where there's a sort of working world in operation show that it's never quite so insulated as a pure interaction of ideas than purely internal history might offer. Right? So I think you'd necessarily need a broader social, political, cultural context of ideas and theories and experiments that is the bread and butter of science. So I don't see myself either as an externalist. I'm certainly not an internalist in terms of historiography. I think you absolutely need to have a sense of both. And in some sense, this heals a rift which opened up 30, 40, 50 years ago in the history of science between those who thought it was just, it should be kept just as internal facts, and those who thought it would be should be opened up, but probably went too far the other way. Whereas I think it depends on which part of the scientific enterprise you focus on. If you look at some parts, it looks internalist. If you bring back and don't see some of the important detail, it looks purely externalist. And I think both extremes are unhelpful, in fact. But you need elements of both to give a good account. So that's my response on that first part of your question. On your second question, which is about the role of the wars, absolutely, I would say of all the working worlds, two are really influential, talking of the 20th century in particular. One is the development of military research, development and its impact. And the second one would be the maintenance of human health, really, because so much is generated by those two concerns. And in terms of the first one that you asked, particularly about wars, if I would say not even the First or Second World Wars, though there's lots of very important developments within those, it's the Cold War, because the Cold War necessitated a permanent mobilization, because there would have been no time to develop research in the context of imminent nuclear attack. So that very fact meant that essentially science and engineering in an important sense was put on a war footing and was well funded for four crucial decades in the second half of the 20th century, ones which had many, many implications for the sciences as they developed. So I would say, of all the conflicts, the Cold War, as a very broad context, is perhaps the most outstanding for understanding the sciences in the 20th century.
Sir, I want to speak that is there any development in science in the beyond history that the mythology come true in the science, because I think there are some point in mythology, especially in Indian mythology, that everyone thought they are mythology, but if science progress at those point, then there means the invention would save the world, like invisible man by putting some powder on his body. Like, means I want to say, is there any development in the past history that mythology come true in reality?
Just checking my understanding, did you say mythology?
Yeah.
As in?
Yes, sir.
So my general response there is that sometimes these are opposed by people. So science is rationality, mythology is something else, right? And if you take a broader view in the history of science, the relationship is certainly far more complicated. So that before 1800, the sciences were organized in a different sort of way. In fact, they weren't really called science, it was more often called natural philosophy. And the common feature of natural philosophy was that it was an exploration of aspects of God, as well as an exploration of nature. Right? So Newton, you know, when he was offering his laws of nature, what did Newton think he was doing? He thought what he was doing was as much theological as it was an exploration of the natural world. Right? Now, and you can find many other examples. I mean, another one in the 19th century would be Michael Faraday, for example, who was a member of a very tiny Protestant Christian sect, right, called the Sandemanians, who had particular views about how people should orientate themselves to the world, to what public service they should offer, should they take money for their services or be motivated by profit, for example. And that shaped certainly his attitude towards public life, but for some historians they see very clearly that, or argue that his religious perspective informed his science. And that's in the 19th century. Of course, in the 19th century, you do have the emergence of a professional scientist body, and part of professionalization was the exclusion, quite actively sometimes, of people like T.H. Huxley, of people who were clergy, right, from roles within science. But again, if you look at it in a broader context, it's often about competing resources, about being able to influence the educational agenda, for example. So what I'm saying is that I those are cases from the history of British science, partly because that's the sort of area that I know more about. But the broader point is that it's no simple relationship between science and mythology, right? But what you should do to understand it is look very carefully at sources and be prepared to think very critically about it. Yeah, and then and think. By critically, I mean you think, well, why is someone saying that? What is their evidence? Approach it, in that kind of critical mindset. So not critically in a negative sense, critical in a positive sense of what counts as a good account. And that goes back to the point I don't think I've got to actually in answer to your question about sources. But it's essential to look at primary sources, because that's the essential data for historians. That's where we can root arguments in. It comes down to what is their evidence for, which is primary sources. But when you're doing a very broad history, it just becomes impossible to get down to the level of primary sources, and you're reliant on picking up what you can from secondary sources of other people's writing, and makes the obligation to continue to be critical even more essential, because you've got to think, how reliable is that secondary source? How do they use them? How do they base their arguments on what evidence? Is that right? What are the alternatives? Can it be challenged? These are always things we should be thinking about.
There's a question.
Actually, if we see that in the 20th century, in the last three decades, the industrial capital has shifted to the finance capital. That is a fact. So how does it affect the direction of science?
Yeah, I understand. That's a very good question, and I think it's patterns of investment are part of the explanation for trends that you see, particularly in the life sciences. If you think about biotechnology and that development of a much more commercialized view about knowledge, okay, and it does seem distinctively different about attitudes towards knowledge. So it was felt at the time in the 1970s that something was changing. People, biologists going to conference in the 1970s said, you know what, it's different this year, because before people were very happy to talk about their work and now they're not. And what had happened is commercial confidence had come in, because different patrons, it was attracting venture capital money, there was more riding on it, it was getting more closed down. Now actually that, you find fewer complaints about that now, but that's because that pattern's now become more ingrained. It's not because it's gone away, it's just become a more typical way of working. But there was, you know, as that change began to happen, it was noticed and complained about. So I do think there is something there about changing sources of investment. Yeah, it's important for understanding history of science.
We'll come back to this question.
Hello, sir.
Hello.
So, in your presentation, you said about some missing pieces of the history, and you said that we need research to find those pieces.
Yeah.
Sir, I would like to know what are the type of the researches that will. What kind of research do we need so that we find out the history?
Yeah.
You know, could you just broaden on the topic?
Well, it would be great to see more history of science done in India on Indian topics, but it needs resources and it needs support. So there are some excellent historians of science in India. Some of them are working on Indian subjects, but there's an extraordinary amount that I don't know and others don't know about sciences as they've developed in India, not just in your apprenticeship science, but that's the one I feel being particularly missing. But that's one of a number of examples of where it'd be fantastic to know more. And I was well aware that I just didn't know what was going on. Some areas where there had been research done, you could see like a sort of patch of light and get to know something there. But you're well aware that there was still plenty that wasn't, that I couldn't find. So it's partly that. It's not just national stories though. There's institutions and episodes and moments that maybe sometimes the archives aren't available. I was talking, I had a fascinating conversation with a scholar in at the IIT actually, where it was a research into the Indian space program, but it was done without access really to primary sources. Still extremely interesting, extremely well done, but you think just how valuable, I mean, even more interesting it would be if access to interesting, those archives could be secured. And so you get these sort of effects where you, where there's sometimes there's no interest, so it's not done. Sometimes it's closed because it's not done. Sometimes it's sensitive, so it's not done. But the cumulative effect is that the history becomes a bit like a Swiss cheese. You know, it's got its parts, but it's also got its lots of holes in that you know, you wonder what's missing, and if the picture would change if it was present.
Professor, your very thought-provoking lecture has raised about a dozen questions. I will address most of them there because time won't permit here. I will raise one or two here.
Thank you.
Your book is Science in the 20th Century and Beyond.
Yes.
So what did you find? What is beyond? Who is going to win? Vivekananda or Dawkins? Are you going to find God, or you are going to make him vanish altogether?
Well, as I said, relations is not just, it's never a simple question as one or the other when it comes to science and religion, okay? So I don't think I think...
Do you pass that in your book?
I do, yes. For example, you know, where there are debates, and one of them, for example, was this, what's called the Scopes Trial, where the teaching of evolution was challenged in US universities and schools, right? And made for a very interesting case study of a clash of values, right? Between those, where you find those sort of instances, that you can learn a lot from them, because it tells you a lot about the values that people hold, and you know, they're brought out into the open in controversies like that. They're always worth studying.
So in the motivations that you showed for the learning of science,
yeah,
I found that your orientation is more towards science as a tool of technology, mere tool of technology. I did not find among the reasons, one of the causes of science is an end in itself. People
yeah.
like to know, they just like to know.
Yeah. Curiosity-driven science.
This part
and if science is driven by curiosity.
By curiosity.
Yeah.
So it need not be a servant to mere technology alone.
I think
you have pointed out in your five or six points.
Okay.
If I may differ, I mean.
No, and I don't. I absolutely agree that curiosity-driven science. Put it this way: Max Planck, when he was doing the work that I was talking about there, which was writing the first equations that had quantum terms. Max Planck almost certainly came into that because he was curious, right? He was very interested in exploring matters of energy and matter and the equations that you could use to represent it. Now, so if you focused in just on him, you would say he's being led by curiosity. And what I find fascinating is when you pan out, you begin to see other things that are pulling him into. So it's
bomb came much later. Planck did not start out to make the bomb.
No, absolutely. I didn't say the bomb.
He started out from his skills. Okay.
Yeah.
Because we are going to go to the dogs.
I like that expression. Very good. I don't.
The answer at this juncture, do we have any
answer? I don't think we'll get an answer. No.
Not yet.
No.
So we always find that there is a schism between science and engineering and technology and science. Don't you think that there shouldn't be one, actually? The two should go hand in hand together and very much together.
Right.
Earlier, science used to lead to engineering. Now it's a reverse which is happening.
Yes.
So why should there be at all any schism among the minds of the scientists and engineers combined? After all, various faculties of science, like biology, decide which is judicious for the society at large.
Yeah.
So that's enough.
Absolutely. There's a term that's sometimes used in my field called techno-science, and we use that because we do think that modern science and technological systems are virtually inseparable, right? So I'm in total agreement with you. I do think, though, that technology and science sort of are different ends. That technology is about designing a more efficient means to an end, with a purpose in mind. Science is mostly about, it's not curiosity driven, it isn't aimless, but it is about precisely that manipulation of modelling of data, of making sense of the world in a different sort of way than technology, but they support each other, they're absolutely complementary, you know, in ways that has become more interconnected over the 20th century, not less.
Thank you. That brings us to an end of the very fruitful question-answer session. Now I invite Professor Anirban Gupta, Associate Dean of External Relations and Alumni Affairs, IIST Shippur, to propose the vote of thanks.
Thank you, Apurna. As we heard in the beginning of this particular lecture session, that Swami Vivekananda was not a monk in the conventional sense. Science was very close to his heart. Special history of science in Indian context, a part of the heritage of India, so he was too much interested with history of science in Indian context too. So this topic on history of science on 20th century is very apt to have in the form of Swami Vivekananda Memorial Oration. And we are so fortunate today that we have amongst us a very renowned exponent of history of science, Professor John Agar from University College of London, and who delivered a lecture for almost an hour and interacted with the audience over here. We are very thankful to you, sir. And we invite you again and again to come to IIST Shippur. You had already some interaction with our Department of Humanities. So I think we'll be having you in future occasions also whenever you travel to India. And we'll be benefited to have interaction and hearing lectures from you, sir. And on behalf of IIST Shippur, our director was very eager to be over here, but his flight is 3 hours delayed in New Delhi, so he still standing up, his flight started from New Delhi, otherwise he would be happy. He told us whether the lecture will be over before he joins here around 5, but unfortunately his flight is delayed. On behalf of IIST Shippur, I'll request Professor B.K. Guho, our Dean Faculty Affairs, to hand over a small token of appreciation, a memento, to Professor John Agar. We are very fortunate to have British Council Kolkata office is helping us to organize this workshop. They arrange for all logistics for Professor John Agar, his travel, his stay. And so we are very thankful to Ms. Sujata Sen and her team from British Council. Ms. Sujata Sen is there in the dais. There are other dignitaries from British Council in the of the dais. So we are very thankful to all of them. We are thankful to the members who came from different other institutes, the South Howrah Citizens Forum, all our students. On behalf of all of them, I again thank Professor John Agar, Ms. Sujata Sen, and the members from British Council. Thank you very much.